From Alumni Fields in Keene, New Hampshire, it's the NECBL on ESPN+. Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Jonah White, joined by Adam Jotkin, as we get set for an interdivisional doubleheader today between the Keene SwampBats and the visiting North Adams SteepleCats. The SwampBats come in with a record of 6-15, their fourth in the North Division. The SteepleCats come in with a record of 5-14. They are fourth in the West Division. Adam, the SteepleCats got off to a rough start this season. They won an opening night, lost 12 that are over. They've rebounded since. What's changed for North Adams?
Absolutely. This team is as streaky as it gets. They won four in a row after that 12-game losing streak. Since then, two losses in a row. This team, I think, always had the talent to be winning ball games. They were just losing in every single way possible. When these teams first played, the Cats were down to the final strike. Boom, home run, and then they lose in extra innings. And there were multiple games that ended like that. Also, this team has had some players come in. Look at Jake Reinish from Wake Forest, Jermaine Cobb from Troy, Cedric Rose from UMass Lowell. Cedric Rose was an all-star in this league last season. So it's been an influx of talent, and the players who have been here all season long are simply just playing to their talent level. They're playing to where they should be playing.
SwampBats have been stuck in a rut recently. They started the season 4-2, but since then they're 2-13 in their last 15 games. They snapped a 7-game losing streak and a doubleheader at Martha's Vineyard on Thursday. They've lost 3 in a row since. They had a tough time in Vermont, losing to the Mountaineers 12-2 and 12-1. They had both games of a double better in Montpelier on Saturday, so they're looking to rebound against the SteepleCats. Adam, I think both teams will see this as an opportunity against struggling opposition to try and pick things up, turn things around standings-wise.
Absolutely. I think these are teams that are probably better than their records standings-wise. The SteepleCats, that record does not look good. You're 5-14. They're 3.5 games back from first place. This season is nowhere close to over. It's not even halfway done, even for the SwampBats. 9 games back again. This season's nowhere close to being done, and, you know, 8 teams make the playoffs in the NECBL, so there's still a lot of time for these teams to get back to the race. But the way summer ball works most of the time, you see completely different teams in the months of June versus July. So these games really matter, even though it's between two last place spots.
Yeah, the SwampBats right now are 3.5 games back of the Danbury Westerners, who occupy the final playoff spot. The SteepleCats are also just 3.5 games back of the Westerners. So like you said, that's with the SwampBats, 23 games left. For the SteepleCats, 25 games left. So there's a lot of season to go, and certainly this doubleheader, a big opportunity for both teams. Let's get to the starting lineups. First for the North Adams SteepleCats, who are 5-14, fourth in the West Division under manager Ryan Abel.
It'll be Kyle Hannon who leads things off. Hannon, the NECBL Player of the Week this past week. Sam Tackett bats second, and the number 3 spot is Jake Reinish. In the cleanup spot, Tremaine Cobb, batting 5th, DM Jefferson. Batting 6th, Cedric Rose. In the number 7 spot is Chad Bourne. Batting 8th, Stewart, and to round out the lineup, batting 9th is Gunnar Johnson. It'll be Dom Marcosio who gets the start on the mound for Cats.
For the SwampBats, they're 4th of the North, 6-15 under Sean McKenna, and Shake Mumar leads. He's the shortstop. Devin Taylor, the Big Ten freshman of the year, is the right fielder batting 2nd. Garrett Rice, the first baseman, will hit 3rd. Blake DeLamelier is the cleanup batter. He's at left field. Jordan Smith, the center fielder, bats 5th. Matt Brown, Ewing is at EH. He bats 6th. Greg Bazo will do the catching and bats 7th. Tony Livermore is the second baseman, batting 8th. And Evan Goforth is the third baseman, batting number 9. The pitching matchup for today's game for the SteepleCats is Dom Marcosio, a senior righty from Wofford, who is 0-0 with a 1.86 ERA. And for the SwampBats, it's Dylan King, junior righty from Dyersburg State, 1-1 with an ERA of 2.07. So a couple of good pitchers going at it in game 1, this one. And again, since it's the first game of a doubleheader, it's a seven-inning contest. Each inning, each batter, each pitch, Adam, matters that much more.
Absolutely, and you know, kind of mentioned this a little bit, but these are two of the best starting pitchers in the entire league, two guys with ERAs below three, so any runs early on will really have a chance to be a difference maker.
Also, anytime you get a doubleheader, bullpen depth is key, so both starters will be looking to go a long way in this game. It'll be Kyle Hannah, the left-hand batting third baseman from Penn State, to lead things off for the SteepleCats. He'll be followed by Sam Tackett and Jake Reinisch as we get going from Keene, New Hampshire at Alumni Field. First pitch of the game, a fastball high from Dylan King. An odd time start at 4:05 p.m. It's 80 degrees and mostly sunny here in the Granite State. 1-0. The ground is shortstop. Tough play for Mumaw. He won't get there. It's into center field for a leadoff single by Kyle Hannon.
Fielding has been a big issue for the Swampbats as of late. They have 38 errors as a team this season, but for Hannon, that just plays pretty well. And you talk about a guy who has been red hot. That's Kyle Hannon, now hitting well over 300. He started this season 0-for.
That'll bring up Sam Tackett, the DH from Virginia Tech. He's having a terrific season. Leads the league in home runs with six. He got two of those at Alumni the first time these two teams met. Tackett batting 279 with an on-base percentage of 438. Six homers and 16 RBIs. All extremely impressive numbers at this point in the season.
Absolutely, and another crazy number is he's walked 17 times and struck out 20.
Runner goes. It's a foul off the catcher's mask of Greg Bozzo. Nothing in two.
So really, any time that Tackett is at the plate, something's going to happen. He's going to hit a home run, a walk, he'll strike out. But he's one of the more fun players in the league. When he hits those home runs most of the time, there are no doubts, and you'll see a pretty big bat flip come out of him.
Runner at first, Kyle Hannon has 10 stolen bases on the season in 12 tries. We'll see if he's running again here on 0-2. Not going. Tackett out in front of a breaking ball, fouls it back. And the count still nothing in two. Dylan King has had a terrific season so far. Three starts, 1-1, ERA of 2.07. 13 innings, given up just eight hits, seven runs, only three of them earned. He's walked four and struck out 17. Hard thrower, and he's got a really good slide. 0-2. On the ground to shortstop. Nice backhand by Mumaw. Goes to second for one. Livermore, what a... Oh, he saved the first. He's getting ready to say what a double play there. Turned by the Swampbats infield. It's still a nifty job by Mumaw to backhand it and get the lead runner. Tackett beats it out at first on a very close play.
Yeah, absolutely. That was an excellent backhand grab at short and almost a picture-perfect 6-4-3 double play, but Tackett just barely beats it out. That's another one of those things that makes him a special player. He's really a five-tool guy.
In real time, Adam, I thought he was out at first. Just got a chance to look at it on the monitor, though, and it does look like Tackett may have indeed beat that out. Here's a grounder to second. This could be two. Livermore for Mumaw on the first. That's a 4-6-3 double play off the bat of Wake Forest's Jake Reinisch. And the inning is over. 4-6-3. The Swampbats get two double play balls, and they do turn one double play here at the top of the first. No runs, a hit, no but left. North Adams nothing, and the Swampbats coming to bat. This is the NECBL on ESPN+.
Turning dreams into reality. In the lab with the formula and chemistry. The memories spark and motivate and make the industry shake. You put the balls in the bricks. I'm talking one chance at best, yes. Hitting pitches for the culture, keep the brushes fresh. Took the trouble, but the drum of passion never rests. Free I'll teach you under pressure, now be blessed. Yeah, it's one all, one shot, not a future for sure.
First thing, first of all, it was quality, the consistency, knowing that when I take them out, they're going to be the same every time. And the second was to be able to see kids all over the country wearing the gloves that I designed. That's one of the coolest parts of it.
Your athletes, empower your coaches, rally your community. Support every team with one solution with the Huddle Athletic Department Package. you put all your school's coaching tools under one roof. From recording to analytics to sharing, with your Huddle AD package, you cover everything. Equal access, equal opportunity, and equal opportunity means full potential. Let's take your department to the next level.
Jonah White, Adam Gottkin with you from Alumni Fields in southern New Hampshire. And the city of Keene as Don Marcosio gets ready to face the Bats at the bottom of the first. Bringing the game to you here on ESPN Plus are Steve Pierce, our director, DJ and our producer, and Brian Hearn on the graphics. It'll be Moomaw, Devin Taylor, and Garrett Rice to start things off for the host Swamp Bats. Against Don Marcosio, 6'5", 200 out of Roswell, Georgia. Senior righty from Wofford College, 4 games, 4 starts, no record, an ERA of 1.86. He's thrown 19 and a third, allowed 17 hits, 6 runs, 4 earned, walked 2 and struck out 15.
It'll be interesting to see Marcosio at Alumni Field. One thing to know about this stadium, very, very shallow. And Marcosio, about 60% slider, so he sees a lot of pop-ups, a lot of fly balls into the outfield. Batters just get under, and at a field like this, it can carry potentially over the fence.
Shake Moomaw takes high ball one. Shake the shortstop out of Florida Gulf Coast for the Swamp Bats. 269 with a 333 on-base percentage. He takes a big swing and a miss at a slide there, and it's 1-1. A lot of off-speed, a lot of sliders, like you said, Adam, from Don Marcosio. It'll be interesting to see if the Swamp Bats could take advantage, like you said, of the small distance here at Alumni Field, as Moomaw fouls that one at the plate. And 2, 354 down the right field line, but 352 to center field, and 325 down the left field line. It's really left center to right center, where you'll see a lot of balls carry over the fence. A short fence as well. The 1-2 is lined foul the opposite way, and it's still 1-2. Give you the SteepleCats defense, Adam.
Behind the plate will be Gunnar Johnson, the college teammate of Marcosio at Wofford. The infield right goes Cedric Rose, Cannon, Jermaine Cobb, or sorry, Cedric Rose, Aiden Stewart, Jermaine Cobb, Kyle Hannon, and the outfield
right
goes DM Jefferson,
caught him on the arm,
Jake Reinisch.
So Moomaw reaches out the 2-strike hit by pitch, and just like North Adams, the Swamp Bats have their opening man on. The up player recruit for today's game, Don Dollar is behind the plate, Alan Libardoni is at first base, and Sam Finn is the umpire at third. Here's Devin Taylor, the Big Ten Freshman of the Year from Indiana, batting 67 with a 320 on base, 2 homers, and 3 runs batted in. A lot of power in that bat. He takes a slider down low, 1-0. Swamp Bats don't run much as a team. They're last with 15 steals of the NECBL. They're also last in average and on-base percentage. It's been a struggle offensively, especially over this recent 2-13 stretch for Keene. And that hits Taylor. Not a good start for Marcosio. Back-to-back hit by pitches.
And very, very uncharacteristic. He's a guy who has one of the better control that you'll ever see. Just 2 walks coming into this outing, and they both came in the same game against Upper Valley, which was his worst start of the year. But here, back-to-back hit by pitches to start. I mean, this is something that you rarely ever see out of the right-hander.
See, the Swamp Bats could take advantage. They'll have Garrett Rice up next. Yeah, Marcosio's only hit one batter in the season so far, but he hits the first 2 right now. So Moomaw at second base, Taylor at first base, nobody out, and the batter will be Garrett Rice, the second-year Swamp Bat from Missouri Southern State. Garrett hitting 176 with a 295 on base. He's got 3 home runs and a team-high 10 runs batted in. A tall right-hander, Marcosio, with the first pitch to Rice, and it's 1-0.
And a If you're Keene, if there's anyone you want at the plate here, it's this guy, as he said, team leader in RBIs. And in these seven-inning games, if you can jump out to an early lead, you give yourself a really good chance.
No. Now, the SteepleCats have done a much better job hitting recently. They're up to third in the league in on-base percentage, but they've been struggling as is pitching staff on the season. 5.49 ERA, that's last out of the 13 teams of the NECBL. So see if that gives the SwampBats an opportunity to have some successes in offense. Rice fouls back the 2-0 pitch, and it's 2-1.
It's been a while since the last time Marcosio actually played in a game. June 24th at Bristol was his last start, so maybe these just, not jitters, but just getting back into the groove of things after a long break.
2-1 pitch, ground ball toward shortstop. They're going to go to third base and get the lead runner, Moomaw. Good play by Tremaine Cobb. Might not have had any other play. It's a 5-6 fielder's choice. Taylor now at second base, and Rice reaches it first.
That's definitely a bit of a risky play to go to third, because if you don't get it, you put yourself in a spot where you load the bases. But Kyle Hannon, who's at third today, also can play first. He's someone who's used to taking in balls like that. And just a nice, easy throw to get out the lead runner and now give yourself a chance to get out of the inning with a double play.
So a big first out. Here's Blake DeLamelier, right-hand batter from Jacksonville University. And he takes a slider for strike, nothing and one. Back-to-back hit by pitches and a fielder's choice. SwampBats still threatening here in the bottom of the first inning. And a seven-inning game. Here's the 0-1. Caught on and missed. Another slider from Marcosio at 83 miles an hour, and it's 0-2.
Well, that's what you did a lot against Marcosio, and maybe it just took him that first out to now get into the groove of things, and seems like Dom has really started to calm down after those two hit-by pitches.
Ahead of DeLamelier, a power-hitting outfielder. And he gets one in the air here, sinking quickly in center, but making the catch is Chad Bourne, and the runners retreat, two men away.
Something interesting you'll see here in Keene, the outfielders are almost close to the warning track, center field with it being like 350, so that's a pretty long run in from Chad Bourne, but makes it look easy, makes the catch, and a nice play there to get the second out.
And now the batter is Jordan Smith, the center fielder from George Mason. Smith has been hitting the ball hard of late, but he's been finding gloves in the outfield on a lot of occasions. He takes high, one ball and no strikes. So two on with two outs. The SwampBats trying to strike first against the SteepleCats. We mentioned briefly these teams meeting for the second time this season. They met very early in the season here at Alumni Field, and the SwampBats won a thriller, 9-8 in 10 innings. This strike, and it's 1-1. Back and forth late in that game. North Adams had led 4-0 most of the way. They traded leads in the late innings. Alec Rich for the SwampBats hit a game-tying home run down to their final strike in the bottom of the ninth, and Aiden Korn won it with a walk-off walk in the 10th.
That still might be the craziest game I've seen all season long. It was one of the most wild baseball games I've ever seen, just of all time.
Hoping for similar drama here on Independence Eve. Two balls and a strike on Jordan Smith. Marcosio gives a look at Taylor on second. And it's a ground ball to shortstop. Trying to tag the runner is Cobb. Now he'll throw to first. In time, it retires the side. Nice job by Marcosio. After hitting the first two men, he retires at X3 and gets out of it. No runs, no hits, no errors. Two men left on base. We go to the second inning, no score in Keene. This is the NECBL on ESPN+. Tremaine Cobb leads off for the SteepleCats in the top of the second inning. The shortstop from Troy, batting 250 with a 286 on base percentage, a homer and six runs batted in. Dylan King deals him a fastball high at 91 miles an hour.
Cobb, one of the hottest hitters in this entire league, named to the NECBL Week 4 honor roll, hit 500 in the last week. Also had a couple doubles, a home run. Hit one 419 in the Vineyard.
Count 3-0 on the leadoff man here in the second inning, Tremaine Cobb. Going to walk the leadoff man if you're Dylan King. There's a strike right down Broadway.
He just took a little bit off the fastball there, 89. He's been up to 92, 93 today, just fired one down the middle.
This one is popped up right side. Garrett Rice might have a play. He does. And there's one out.
Had a really nice job from King to just bounce back after a rough start to the at-bat, throw two strikes and force a pop-up.
Take a look at the SwampBats defense. Greg Bazo is a catcher. Garrett Rice, Tony Livermore, Jake Mumma, Evan Goforth. That's right to left on your infield. Left to right in the outfield, Blake DeLamelier, Jordan Smith, and Devin Taylor. Here's DM Jefferson from Notre Dame. He flies one to left. DeLamelier doesn't have to move very far. Two outs.
Outs there for Dylan King. We mentioned this a little bit early on, but seven inning doubleheader. If you can continue to get quick outs like this and work fast, then you put your team in a really good spot because relievers are not as, you know, plentiful as you normally see.
The 6'4 righty Dylan King now dealing to Cedric Rose, the first baseman from UMass Lowell. Strike one. Rose batting 254 with a 500 on base percentage this season, two homers and five RBIs. Sliced foul toward the SwampBats bullpen, nothing and two.
That high on base percentage is exactly what Ryan Abel, the manager, is looking for his players to get quality at bats. If it's a hit, if it's a walk, he doesn't really care. He wants guys on base.
0-2 pitch. The ground is shortstop. A routine play for Jake Mumma. A 1-2-3 inning for Dylan King. And we go to the bottom of the second. Still no score between North Adams and Keene. This is the NECBL on ESPN+. Located in Swansea, just south of Keene. Bottom of the second here from Keene. No score between the SwampBats and the SteepleCats. Dylan King's only thrown 16 pitches and thrown two scoreless innings against the SteepleCats. Tom Marcosio had to work through some stressful situations in the first inning. He hit the first two SwampBats, but he got a fielder's choice, a fly out and a ground out to get out of it unscathed. Matt Brown Earing leads off for the bats of the second inning as it starts to drizzle here. Matt is from Stony Brook University on Long Island, hitting 140 but with a very respectable on-base percentage of 339. Starting DH for the SwampBats in this game.
The weather definitely something to keep an eye on. It has been a big story here in Keene. The post-game fireworks today postponed to, what is it, July 28th?
July 28th. The post-game fireworks in Keene that were supposed to happen today. Now, like you said, the anticipated weather, those were postponed. 2-1 on Matt Brown Earing. It's hot, but it's now got some clouds over us. We had some drizzle a moment ago, and it looks like still very slight drizzle right now this afternoon.
If you look beyond center field, it's perfect. Blue skies, it's just when you get towards behind home plate, that's where the clouds start to get a little bit darker.
Balls, two strikes on Brown Earing after the check swing foul. Brown Earing, Greg Bosco, and Tony Livermore, the bats at the bottom of the second inning. 2-2 the count. Now the pitch. Way upstairs, 3-2. Matt Brown Earing tends to work really good at bats. That's why his on-base percentage is 199 points higher than his batting average. He's the SwampBats leader this season with 13 walks. Make it 14. Lead-off walk from Matt Brown Earing.
third walk. Marcosi was given up this season and now more than 20 innings, and his catcher, Gunnar Johnson, is going to meet him on the mound because of that. This is one of the more rare things that you'll see in the entirety of the New England League here, is the pitcher and catcher being from the same school, both from Wofford College. So you do think that is something that can really help the SteepleCats in this first game, is the chemistry between these two. When things do get rough for Marcosio, he has a guy behind the plate who really knows how to calm him down and make sure that he can just focus on pitching and everything else is going to be good.
That's definitely advantage, a big advantage relative to most of the guys, which are brand new to each other. Greg Bozzo from Northeastern lies a base hit into left field. Stopping at second is Matt Brown-Earing, and for the second inning in a row, the Swamp Bats have the first two men on.
That's just a really good hit there from Greg Bozzo. Low and away, and he just went right through it, sent it to the left side. And for the second inning in a row, runners on first and second with no outs for Keene. Last time, Marcosio was able to get out of it. Another tough situation.
Here's Tony Livermore, who's 3-for-8 in his last three games. Left-hand batting second baseman from Northwestern. His batting average up to .216 for the season, on base percentage .256. Hannon in at third in case he lays down a bunt, which he does. It's a beauty. Hannon, bare hands, no play. Base is loaded for the Swamp Bats on a beautiful bunt single by Tony Livermore.
Yeah, that was absolutely gorgeous. Perfect from Livermore. And for a guy who's been struggling so much at the plate this season, that can be key. You just get on base now. And now that gives you a chance to kind of just feel to be there and then continue to work. That, but here the Swamp Bats, this is just a perfect inning if you are the coaching staff. If you're Sean McKenna, you get a walk, a classic hit, and then a bunt base hit.
Here's Evan Goforth, third baseman for the University of Indiana. Corners in the middle back, they'll give out up a run for two outs as Marcosio misses inside with ball one. Big chance for the Swamp Bats after they squandered first and second. Nobody out in the top of the first. They've got the bases loaded with nobody out of the second. And it's one and one. She said the bottom of the first. Now the bottom of the second here. And the Bats looking to get on the board for the first time. Goforth, the number nine hitter with a 1-1 count. The pitch way upstairs. Marcosio just seems to be struggling with his command quite a bit in the early going. That was an 87 mile an hour fastball way up and in. See if he goes back to his go-to pitch slider on 2-1. Go for it. Hits a ground ball to the left side. Tough play for Cabo. Put it in his pocket. Another infield single for the Swamp Bats. It's an RBI for Evan Goforth, his second of the season. Matt Brown-Earing scores. It's 1-0 Swamp Bats, and the first four men have reached here in the second inning.
And that a really smart decision from Tremaine Cobb to put that ball in his pocket, not try and force a throw to first, because if that's an error, at least one more run is scoring. Instead, you give your pitcher a chance here to get the outs and not trying to do too much in the field.
And just by cutting the ball off on the infield, Cobb saved at least a run for now. But the bases remain loaded for the top of the order. Jake Mumo is hit by a pitch his first time up. Jake batting .269 on the season. First pitch to him. Down and in, one ball and no strikes. Dangerous hitter Devin Taylor is due up on deck. Rose, the first baseman, in on the grass. Handed the third baseman in near the cut of the grass. Cobb and Stewart. Double play depth up the middle of the outfield straight away. Ground ball right side. Waiting for it is Stewart. His only plays at first. It's an RBI ground out for Jake Mumo. All three runners move up, including Bozzo, who scores from third. It's 2-0 Swamp Bats.
This is small ball to its finest here from the Keene Swamp Bats. A couple infield singles, a walk to start the inning, and two runs come from it. Even though this is a boombox, this is a hitter's ballpark, you don't always have to get it done that way.
Here's Devitt Taylor. He's first pitch swinging. That's one off the end of the bat, foul down the right field side, nothing in one. With second and third and one out, the SteepleCats keep the middle of the infield back. Handed is in at third base, and the first baseman Rose has also moved back. So a ground ball to anyone but the third baseman will make it 3-0 Keene. Taylor fouls this one back, and he's behind it, an 0-2 hole.
That slider from Marcosio up in the zone, you'll see him go to the slider up a lot. He's not a guy who's just going to pound it low and away. Because it's his go-to pitch, because it's thrown about 60% of the time, it'll be all throughout the zone.
Trying to finish off Taylor. Marcosio deals 0-2, and he spikes one. They spiked it so early that it wasn't that difficult of a block, in truth, for Gunnar Johnson.
Gunnar Johnson is really good at putting those sliders in the dirt behind the plate. It's one of the main reasons he has started every single one of Marcosio's starts, outside the fact that they're at Wofford together, is because he's so good at blocking pitches. It's exactly like that.
1-2, swung on and missed, strike three. Got him with an elevated fastball. Big first strikeout for Marcosio. And now the batter is Garrett Wright.
And if you're Taylor there, you see the fastball coming right down the middle of the plate, it seemed like, but upstairs, and he just couldn't hold up on it.
Rice hit into a 5-6 fielder's choice his first time up, as the whole infield moves back now for North Adams. Garrett hits a ground ball to the left side. It's through for a base hit. One run will score. Livermore around third. He'll score without a throw. Excuse me, that's Goforth, but it's 4-0 SwampBats on a two-run single by Garrett Rice.
And Garrett Rice just continues to bring guys in, not even hitting 200 on the season. But that's now 12 RBIs for the first baseman, just getting it done when it matters.
Livermore scoring from third. Goforth coming around to score from second on the wave from Coach McKenna. Two-run base hit for Garrett Rice, who continues to get it done in clutch situations. Now 12 RBIs out of the season for him, and the batter is Blake DeLamelier. Swings and misses over the slider, nothing in one.
And that a beautiful pitch from Marcosio. As his shortstop, Tremaine Cobb, says, there it is, let's lock in. Just try and get out of this inning here if you're Marcosio. This is the most runs that he's given up in a start so far this season.
0-1 pitch to Blake. Fast ball outside at 90 miles an hour, 1-1.
Marcosio hadn't given up more than two earned runs in a start all season long, and that was back in the game of the season against Valley, in which he gave up 2-4 2/3.
DeLamelier swings and misses there to make the count 1-2. This is the third four-run inning of the season for the Keene SwampBats. One of those was the very first inning of the season. Other four-run inning was also against the SteepleCats to tie the game at 4. The game the SwampBats would go on to win 9-8. 1-2 pitch, swung on and missed, strike three. Slider in the dirt, throw to first from Johnson, will complete the second strikeout for Marcosio. But a big second inning for the SwampBats. 4 runs on 4 hits, no errors, and 1 left. 4-0 Keene. This is the NECBL on ESPN+. Chad Bull leads off the third for the SteepleCats. Adam?
Thank you very much, Jonah. First pitch is going to be in for a strike. Jonah White, Adam Gatkin with you here. You're watching the New England League on ESPN+. For those who knew, the NECBL, one of the more special leagues, not just when it comes to baseball, also when it comes to broadcasting, as that grounded to short. The throw to first from Muma is in time, and that's out number one. But the way things work here in the New England League is the broadcasters for both teams come together. Jonah's with the SwampBats, I'm with the SteepleCats, and we trade off the innings. The home broadcaster will do the first innings, the way broadcaster does the middle, and then the home broadcaster will finish out the games. It's one of the more cool things that you'll see anywhere in the entire country as the first pitch to Aiden Stewart is in for a strike and the count 0-1 to the second baseman.
Aiden Stewart out of Delaware.
Joined the team a little bit late. Originally from the Rochester, New York area. Transferring to Delaware from Siena College, where he played his freshman year and started almost every game, hitting the high 200s as a swing and a miss on a nice off speed, and it's 1-2. Rain continues to fall at a steady
A little bit more for you about the NECBL if you're new to this league. It's a 13-team league in 2023, covering all six New England states, one of the premier collegiate summer leagues in the country.
Count now full to Aiden Stewart.
Nearly 150 MLB alumni have played in this league.
Stewart lifts one towards left, and oh, DeLamalier will get there in time, and he makes a nice sliding grab for out number two.
Nice play by Blake. Swampbats have really good outfield defense in DeLamalier, Smith, and Taylor. You know, Keene, as we mentioned this season, have struggled recently defensively. They are 12th in the league with a .950 fielding percentage. They've made 38 errors, but you look at the guys out there, and there's good defense all over the fields with this nine.
It's Gunnar Johnson at the plate. He struggled a lot at the plate this year, hitting under 100. One of his four hits, a double. That came back against Samford as he laces one towards center field, and it is out of here. Gunnar Johnson with the solo home run, his first blast of the season, and the SteepleCats get one back. It's 4-1 here in the top of the third inning.
It's the nine hitter, Gunnar Johnson, hitting one 389 feet to straightaway center into the hedge. With an 82-mile-an-hour fastball from Kay that was down the middle and sent it far up the middle.
Gunnar Johnson helping out his pitcher, getting a run back, and that brings back up the top of the order now in Kyle Hannon, who had the only base hit before that blast from Gunnar Johnson of the day for the Cats, as the first pitch outside on an off-speed at 74, and it's 1-0. One of the things that makes Dylan King so good is his change of velocity, almost 20 miles an hour between his top fastball and the lowest velocity of the off-speed. Kyle Hannon out of Penn State, the Nittany Lions found their new head coach today, taking Gambino from Boston College as Hannon rips one towards center, and Smith just makes the catch as the ball dives toward the grass. And that is out number three. But the SteepleCats get a run back on a Gunnar Johnson solo home run into center field. It's a three-run ball game. You're watching the NECBL on ESPN+.
I said, watch me do my shake, shake. Woo! Watch me do my thing. I said, watch me do my shake, shake.
At Keene State College, life is an adventure. You'll forge your path forward. As an owl, you'll take on challenges in the classroom, field, court, or track. Every worthwhile adventure has its share of blood, sweat, and tears. It takes hard work and dedication. No owl flies alone on their journey at Keene State. Teammates, coaches, professors, alumni, and fellow owls are with you along the way. They lift you up as you continue forward. When you're part of Owl Nation, you become the person you truly want to be.
Your next Ford is waiting at Monadnock Ford. Right now, get a great offer like this on your next new Ford. See these offers and more at MonadnockFord.com. Monadnock Ford, home of the low-price tire guarantee and your local Ford and used car retailer. Voted Keene's best.
Yeah.
Adam Gatkin and Jonah White with you here on the NECBL on ESPN Plus. It's 4-1. The SwampBats lead the SteepleCats. The setting of today's game, Alumni Field in Keene, New Hampshire, an absolutely gorgeous ballpark. And this, another one of the things that makes the New England League so special is the settings of these games. You've got Alumni Field, you go down to Newport and Cardine's Field. You got a team on Martha's Vineyard and the Sharks. They'll be on ESPN Plus later as they take on the Newport Goals, but the ballparks here are just special.
Oh, absolutely. There's a number of things that make this New England Collegiate Baseball League special, and the ballparks are certainly high on that list.
First pitch of the third to Jordan Smith, fouled off, and it's 0-1. Ground to short to end the first inning his first time up. All four runs came in that second inning for the Bats. Is stranded two on in the first. Nicosio hoping for a quicker inning here. Swing and a miss, and the right-hander ahead 0-2.
NECBL founded in 1993 under former minor leaguer and award-winning TV producer Joseph Constantino. First commissioner was former MLB star with the Mets and the Reds, George Foster.
That ball laced towards right center field. Born back, he looks up, and it's over the scoreboard. Jordan Smith with the two-run home run, 357, but that'll get it done here at Alumni Field, and it's 5-1 SwampBats.
First homer of the season for Smith, who, like I said, has been hitting the ball hard, but oftentimes lining out. The defense on that one, though, over the right center field scoreboard, 357 feet.
Just 89 miles an hour off the bat. Definitely not a rocket, but it goes over. It goes over, and that run makes it 5-1 and brings Matt Brown Earing to the plate. He walked in and scored the first run of the game last inning. First pitch is fouled off. That ball lifted high in the air towards left. Jefferson ranging back and just shy of the warning track. He'll make the catch for out number one. So another high hit ball, this time stays within the yard. That brings Greg Bozzo to the plate.
Adam, it definitely seems like this is not a ballpark suited to Don Marcosio. Fly ball pitcher. Alumni Field do not go together very well.
Not at all. Also gives up a lot of softly hit balls in the infield, and the grass here at Alumni Field very thick, so ball rolls slow, but that one rolls pretty fast in the outfield, and it's a one-out single for Greg Bozzo, his second hit of the day.
Greg Bozzo continues to swing a hot bat. He leads the SwampBats batting average coming into this game at 273. An aggressive hitter, now 2-for-2 in this game.
Brings up Tony Livermore. He singled his last time up. Left-handed hitter. Livermore, originally from Chicago, Illinois, plays his college ball in his hometown at Northwestern University. Nine in the box. Watches the first pitch. Fastball at 89 miles an hour. Cosio kicks and deals, and that ball ripped towards left. Jeff in, now back, and it's over his head. Misplayed in left field. Bozzo around second. He's to third. Stopped there. Into second, standing up is Livermore with the double.
Jefferson got totally turned around on that ball. He started in and to the left. He had to backtrack behind him, but it was too late. Livermore with the double.
So that puts runners on second and third now with one out for Evan Goforth. had the RBI single with the bases loaded in the last inning to open up the scoring. That was the second RBI of the season. Now a base hit to give him 3-4. Sounds like some action over in the SteepleCats bullpen, but that out of our view. Try and get a name on that. First pitch to go forth in the dirt, and it's 1-0. Seven hits in this game already for Keene. Just in the bottom of the third inning. It's that fastball way up there, and it's 2-0.
Adam, we've got Reed Interzanato, righty from William and Mary, who has not pitched for the SteepleCats, warming up in the bullpen.
Otto, the transfer from Monmouth, so good chance we'll see him for the first time. Marcosio wants to get out of this inning himself. 2-0 the count to go forth as that pitch is bounced up the middle. It'll get through for a base hit, and two runs will score. Make it 7-1 SwampBats here in the bottom of the third.
How about the bottom three of the SwampBats batting order? They are now 6-for-6, twice through. Go forth with a 3-RBI day here in the third inning.
Lazo and Livermore cross home for the second time each. And that brings up the top of the order, and Jake Mumo, who had an RBI on a ground out his last time up. And here comes Ryan Abel out of the SteepleCats bullpen, and he will motion towards it. And so this will be the end of the day for Dom Marcosio. Goes 2 1/3 inning, gives up 8 hits, strikes out 2, and walks 1. Don't have that final line yet as the runner on first still to his name, but Reed Interdonato will head in for his first appearance with the SteepleCats. We will send things to break on the NECBL on ESPN Plus with the score 7-1. SwampBats leading the SteepleCats in the bottom of the third. In the midst of a sun shower, the SteepleCats make the first pitching change of the day. It will be Reed Interdonato, the right-hander, will be playing next year at William and Mary. Spent his two seasons at Monmouth and was on the Cape before joining the Cats. Made one appearance with the wear and statement. An inning and 2/3, gave up 2 earned runs on 1 hit and 3 walks. Will face Jake Mumo first with Evan Goforth on first base.
This is the largest lead the SwampBats have had in any game this season. Their biggest win of this season is by 3 runs, a 7-4 victory over the Vermont Mountaineers earlier. This has been a huge offensive output from the SwampBats, who previously been struggling hitting the ball.
All the runs have come from the bottom of the order. 6 through 9 have scored all but one, and the one outside of that was a Jordan Smith solo home run. He's the number 5 hitter. Leadoff man, Jake Mumo. Did have an RBI, though, as the runner's going. That pitch outside, throwing to second from Johnson, will bounce in way too late. And that's a stolen base for Goforth.
Second steal of the season for Evan Goforth. Just the 16th steal for the SwampBats as a team. It's not something they do a ton, but picked a good time there.
For Interdonato this past year at Monmouth, an ERA up at 9.07. Pitched 45 innings as a starter. Walked just 27, but down 3-1 here. Fastball in the 90s. Get it up towards about 94 miles an hour. That last one at 91. The pitch, and that up and away, ball 4. It's a 5-pitch walk, and that's not how Interdonato wanted to start his outing. Brings up Devin Taylor.
struck out his last time up, was one of just two Marcosio strikeout victims. The book not closed yet on the Seattle Wofford, as the runner at second base, Goforth, still attributed to him. So we'll get you the final line either once Goforth scores or once this inning ends, as that popped up third base side. Hannon looking into the sun in foul territory. He makes the catch for out number two. Bring up Garrett Rice, who had a two RBI single his last time up. Here with two on and two outs in the bottom of the third inning.
That was a crucial clutch hit for Rice. A ground ball right through the 5-6 hole for RBIs 11 and 12 on the season.
The team leader in RBIs, even though he's hitting just 189. Fouls off the first pitch, straight back, 0-1. Another fastball at 93 there, Interdonato. Brought here partially by Jonathan Peterson from Monmouth. After being on a temporary contract with Wareham, as that pitch misses, and it's 1-1. Check swing, doesn't matter, it's a called strike, and it's 1-2. And Interdonato a chance to get out of this bottom of the third inning, in which the SwampBats have added on three more. The 1-2, that's fouled off. Rice will stay alive. Interdonato, originally from Scottsdale, Arizona, stands at 6'3", 215 pounds on the mound, going into his junior season of eligibility. The kick and the pitch, and that bounce first base side. Rose will take it himself, and that is out number three, but not before the SwampBats explode, add on three more runs on four hits, no errors, two left, and we move in to the fourth inning. You're watching the NECBL on ESPN+. 7-1 the score, as we're into the fourth inning here from Alumni Field in Keene, New Hampshire. Adam Gack and Jonah White with you. Sam Tackett, the NECBL home run leader, will take the first pitch in for a strike in the count 0-1. Tackett with six bombs this season. Two of them came here at Alumni Field, as 0-2 the count.
Sun shower continues here in Keene.
And a swing and a miss on a nasty off speed. And a three-pitch strikeout to Sam Tackett to start the fourth.
That's that devastating slider from Dylan King. It's his first strikeout of the day, his eighth of the season.
Dylan King absolutely mowing down batters. He's given up one run. That was a Gunnar Johnson solo shot in the last inning. Jake Reinisch to the plate now. Grounds it into a inning-ending double play back in the first. First pitch misses in the count 1-0. Reinisch, a native of Clifton Park, New York, just a little bit north of Albany, sends a foul down the left line. Was about an hour or so, a little bit more away from North Adams. Started 60 games and hit over 300 back in 2022, but was injured in the second game this season, and so just a pinch hitter this past year for the Demon Deacons, as he ropes one towards first. Rice will knock it down and step on first, 2-2.
Adam, let's take a quick look at the out-of-town scoreboard today in the NECBL. The Mystic Schooners beat the Ocean State Waves 5-2 at Dodd Memorial Stadium in Norwich, Connecticut. That's the only final so far today. North Shore and Sanford getting underway shortly. Later this evening, there'll be Vermont and Upper Valley, Danbury and Valley. Martha's Vineyard in Newport is postponed. And Game two here.
Cobb takes a strike at the knees in the count 0-2. King looking for a 1-2-3 inning, and he'll two just that on an absolutely filthy slider. And the Cats go down in order. Strikeouts number 1 and 2 for Dylan King, and that'll send us into the middle of the fourth. You're watching the NECBL on ESPN+.
At M&T Bank, we believe in the power of together. Together, we can help your business grow. Together, we can move communities forward while giving back. Together, we can help your family spend more time on what matters most. And together, we can achieve more than ever before.
Welcome to Hurt Skirt, or just Hurt. Our first contestant is suffering from knee pain from a recent running incident. What do we think, audience? Hurt Skirt or just Hurt? Why not try Hurt Skirt? Your recovery hassle-free with Hurt Skirt, a patent-pending, stretch-to-fit, hot-cold therapeutic sleeve proven to stay cold longer and still remain completely mobile. Drop the ice, hurt the hurt.
Curious about the awesome talent Kelly has? Well, here are some robotics specialists. This group works in telecom on 5G. They work on autonomous vehicles. Those are education professionals. Oh, and system analysts, contact center reps, biologists. There's data scientists, substitute teachers, mechanical engineers, not to mention people who work on-site and off-site. Kelly's got top talent in specialized and emerging skill sets, ready to help your business prepare for what's next.
Back from Alumni Field, 7-1, the SwampBats lead the SteepleCats. And a reminder, this is just a 7-inning game. And Jonah, you and I were talking about this off the air, but during 7-inning games, the question comes up, when do you play the 7th-inning stretch? Most of the time, it's in the 5th. You say keep it in the 7th. I was keeping this in my back pocket to win this battle when we got on air. However, if the SwampBats win this game, we won't get to the bottom of the 7th. So,
you play it
after a win? When do you play? Take me out to the ball game.
Well, you don't need to stretch if it's over after 6.5 innings. You've been sitting down that long. You know, the purpose of the 7th inning stretch is, you know, to stretch. So, I think if the game's over then, it's stretching anyway. But I think it's a 7th inning stretch. Why have it in the 5th inning?
To change the name to the 5th inning stretch. But either way, the count 1-2 here to Garrett Rice. Can give you a final line now for Don Marcosio. 2 1/3 innings. He allowed 8 hits, 7 runs. All 7 were earned. Walk 1, struck out 2. As a swing and a miss, strike 3 to Rice. Or sorry, apologies. That's Blake DeLamelier. And that is out number 1 of the bottom of the 4th. Garrett Rice was the last out of the 3rd. He went out 3 via a unassisted put out to first base. So again, that was DeLamelier. And that the first strikeout for Intertonado. First pitch sent in the air towards center field. Born back just shy of the wall. He leaps and he makes the catch.
I think he took that one back.
Oh my goodness, Chad Bourne with some highway robbery. And just like that, we've got two gone. Jordan Smith, oh so close to his second home run of the game.
I think that was going over.
What a play there from the center fielder out of Coastal Carolina. First pitch to Matt Brown Earing is a called strike in the count 0-1.
It's the second home run robbery we've seen this season on Alumni Field. Blake DeLamelier made the other.
Fouled off and 0-2. Intertonado a chance to go 1-2-3. He walked the first pitcher he faced, since then straight outs. Right-hander comes into the line. Kick in the pitch, and that bounces on the plate. Swamp Bats have not gone down 1-2-3 today as that rip to the right side just past the diving Rose and into right field. It's a two-out single. And this strong day offensively for the Swamp Bats continues.
Yeah, especially the bottom of the lineup now. 6-9. The Swamp Bats are 7-8 with a walk and 6 runs scored.
Greg Bazo, the number 7 hitter, 2-for-2 today, fouls the first pitch off, and it's 0-1. Believe the rain has stopped now. It's hard to tell with the sun coming down.
It looks like it has.
Believe no more rain. And again, the field looks fine, even though it was coming down for a while, as that pitch is popped up towards center field. Bourne loses it in the sun, now finds it and makes the grab for out number 3. And so that will do it for the bottom of the 4th inning. No runs, 1 hit, no errors, 1 left on base. 6 run lead for the Swamp Bats. You're watching the NECBL on ESPN Plus. Back on ESPN Plus, you're watching the New England League. 7-1, the Keene Swamp Bats lead the North Adams SteepleCats. Dylan King back on to the hill, and he's just been dominant so far, hasn't he?
He's been terrific, and honestly, it's nothing less than we expected. King has just been fantastic this season for the Swamp Bats. High-velocity fastball, really good slider with a lot of bite to it. Very difficult pitcher to face, and he's a guy, Adam, out of a lot of guys at the NECBL who's got hopes of being selected in the upcoming Major League Baseball draft this summer.
First pitch to Dean for ball in the count 1-0. That's off the plate, 2-0. As you said, King a potential pick in this year's MLB draft. A number of players on each team most likely to be selected this year, and if not this year, next year and the year after that. Baseball, by far one of the more interesting sports when it comes to draft eligibility. If you're from a junior college like Dylan King is, you can be drafted at any time. However, if you're playing in the NCAA, you need to have accumulated 3 years at that school. So it could be a red shirt and 2 years of eligibility, playing all 3 years, 2 red shirts and 1 year playing, but 3 years, and then you can go to the draft as DM Jefferson walks. And that brings up Cedric Rose. Of course, you can also be drafted at a high school. Just so many different ways to make it to affiliated ball.
Watching the stars of the future right here in Keene, New Hampshire.
First pitch 0-1.
For proof of that, Adam, you have to look no further than the 2023 MLB All-Star rosters. 3 New England Collegiate Baseball League alumni represented on those rosters.
As Rose hits one in the air towards right field, just shy of the warning track, it will be Taylor who makes the catch for out number 1.
Will Smith played for the Newport Gulls, a catcher for the Dodgers. Josiah Gray, pitcher, played with the Danbury Westerners. And Brent Rooker, a DH for the Oakland A's, played for the Plymouth Pilgrims, formerly of the NECBL.
Chad Bourne will head to the plate. Another guy who has a good chance of seeing his name called, was named the 24th best prospect in the Sun Belt League before this past season, and the Sun Belt League one of the best in the entire country.
They
as
call
a balk,
balk
call. That's a balk on Dylan King, and so DM Jefferson will get second.
Should not see what he did. I'm gonna get a look at our monitor here.
Rare things in all of baseball. Balk puts a runner in scoring position.
Just watch that back. I think it was one of the base umpires that called it. Maybe he never fully came set. That's all I could guess. It didn't seem like anything really jumped out at me as to why the balk was called. But anyway, Jefferson over to second base.
Count 1-0 to Bourne. And again, Bourne, a guy who preseason was in talks of making it to the draft, and he had one heck of a year at Coastal Carolina, hitting in the high 200s.
Had a chance to see Chad Bourne last year when I was working in the Alaska Baseball League.
Was initially at Miami before going up to Conway, South Carolina to play for the Chanticleers. 2-0 pitch, fouled off. Bourne wearing his Coastal Carolina helmet with the teal bill. That's one of my favorite things when players wear their college helmets. It makes things just feel a little bit more special, that old All-Star game type of feel where you can kind of really see where everyone's from and not just hear it.
Yeah, I hate that they make wear the new uniforms now in the MLB All-Star game.
The pitch low and 3-1 to Bourne. It was always best when everyone wore their home uniforms. And
the All-Star game used to matter, too.
Yeah, it used to decide who had home field advantage in the World Series.
I like that.
Made
it very interesting.
Made it really matter. Is the 3-1 to Bourne. Just in for a strike at the knees. The Cats center fielder disagrees, was unwrapping all of his protective gear, but that a perfect pitch from Dylan King.
Yeah, right to the knees. Good call from Don Galley, the home plate umpire.
And so the count now full with Jefferson at second, who has got a ton of speed. Base hit would score the man from Notre Dame. The payoff pitch, and that fouled off. Base coaches for the Steeple Cats. It's the manager, Ryan Abel, at third, and at first, the hitting coach, Colin Scott. Just two hits in this game so far for North Adams. One of them a home run from Gunnar Johnson. Bourne fouls off another one as we continue on.
And I'm continuing to talk just a little bit about the NECBL. It's in its 29th season. A Woodbat Summer League. Some of the best college players from all over the country come to play in the six New England states for the summer. SwampBats were founded in 1997. They've won the second most titles in the history of the NECBL. Five, including most recently in 2019. SteepleCats founded in 2002, still looking to capture their first Faye Vincent Senior Cup Championship.
That pitch up and away, just barely misses, ball four. And at the second walk of this inning from Dylan King, puts runners on first and second for Aiden Stewart.
King still at 92 miles an hour there at that fastball. He's walked two of the first three batters here in the fifth, but those are his first two walks of the game. And it's the bottom of the order coming up now, and Stewart, the eight hitter.
As you said, team every state in New England in this league, and really cool chance for the players to travel, explore new places. I know just talking with SteepleCats players, there are a lot of them who had never been to New England before. Now they can say, at least so far this year, they've been to Connecticut, Rhode Island, Vermont, New Hampshire. Cats still haven't made it to Maine yet, but you can get to go everywhere.
It's a nice stadium up there in Sanford, Maine.
Talking on the mound.
Yeah, it's Hunter Cooley, the SwampBats pitching coach out there. In terms of SwampBats alumni, the Bats have NECBL Hall of Famer Andre Ethier is one of the 35 names on the Key to the Big Leagues alumni list. Also Andy LaRoche, Brian Wilson, Matt Den Decker, and many more. The SteepleCats Major League alumni list is Joe Smith, former longtime Major League sidearmer. And Adam, at the first Major League I ever went to, the Mets or the Brewers, the Mets lost 12-3 and Joe Smith gave up a grand slam. So when I saw that name looking at the Cats alumni, it jumped out at me. I always liked Joe Smith. You know, it was a great introduction to being a Mets fan. Back in 2007.
Another SteepleCats alumni in the NECBL, Zach Netto, who is already in the big leagues. He played for the Cats in 2021, and he's already playing for the Angels. His MLB debut a few months ago was the first member of the 2022 draft class to make it to the big leagues, and he gives Ryan Abel a lot of credit for his development. Abel actually coached Neto at the Brewster Whitecaps in the Cape Cod League as that pitch outside, and a four-pitch walk to Aiden Stewart. And Dylan King has now walked the bases loaded here in the fifth for Gunnar Johnson, who hit a home run his last time up. Another one would make this just a two-run ball game.
Yeah, King, who was smooth sailing through the first four innings. That was his only blemish, the home run to Johnson. He was facing just one over the minimum, but three walks in the first four batters here in the fifth inning, and the swap bats will get Tyler Tornberg stretching in the bullpen, but only just now. So King has got to face at least this batter, if not the next couple.
Well, there's a nasty breaking ball on the first pitch to Gunnar Johnson, so maybe King figuring it out after the four-pitch walk. Maybe just trying to make things interesting here in a six-run ball game.
It's a beautiful pitch.
That in the dirt, and an absolutely picture-perfect block for Greg Bazo to stop the runner from third scoring.
Bats have Garrett Rice, the first baseman, in on the infield pass. Everybody else is back. But the bats up to one in the inning of a seven-inning ball game. They just want outs here. It's okay if a run two comes in to score.
King and deals, and Johnson sends that one deep left center field, and it is going to bounce to the wall. Jefferson scores, here comes Bourne. Stewart will get the stop sign at third. It's a two RBI double for Gunnar Johnson. Have a day, Gunnar. No RBIs coming into this one, and now he's got three.
Cats right back into this game. 7-3 with two in scoring position, back to the top of the order.
So for Gunnar Johnson, a home run and a double. He's got all the RBIs for the Cats today, and that brings up Kyle Hannon, the NECBL Player of the Week here with one out and two in scoring position. First pitch from King, outside on a fastball, and it's 1-0.
Swamp Bats will keep the infield back all the way around here, except for Evan Goforth, who's just behind the bag at third. About halfway.
1-0, swing and a miss on a heater down the middle, and it's 1-1.
Tornberg now throwing off the bullpen mound down the right field line. See if King can get out here.
King kicks and deals, and Hannon grounds that one towards second. Bobbled by Liverpool. Throw to first is in time, but Stewart will score from third, and another run for the Cats makes it 7-4 with now Sam Tackett coming to the plate.
Three-run inning now for the SteepleCats against Dylan King, who had been having nothing but success. A dangerous hitter coming up now at Tackett.
An RBI for Hannon is eighth of the year as the first pitch to Tackett. Change up at the knees, a called strike. Another off-speed. He's got Tackett swinging out of his shoes. King up 0-2. The chance to get out of this inning after three runs have crossed. Into the wind, the pitch. And that way outside. Hunter Johnson on third. As a swing and a miss on a pitch in the dirt. Bazo has it. Throw to first in time. And that will do it for the fifth inning. But the SteepleCats roar back, score three runs on just one hit. Strand a runner on third, no errors. As we move into the sixth now with the score 7-4, you're watching the NECBL on ESPN+. 7-4 the score here as we move into the bottom of the fifth inning. Adam Gotkin and Jonah White with you. Reed Donato back onto the hill for what will be his second full inning of work. Last time out, he gave up one hit, and then that struck out a batter and gave up two fly outs to center. Tony Livermore will lead off, and he has been red hot today with a single, a double, and two-run score.
Yeah, Livermore continues to swing a really hot bat. He's now 5 for his last 10.
That's the first appearance for Inter Donato in the New England League this summer. First pitch, a check swing, doesn't matter, it's in the zone, and the count 0-1. And Inter Donato started his summer on the Cape Cod League. He'll be transferring to the College of William and Mary for next season as that fastball upstairs. It's 1-1. Fastball at 92 miles an hour from the right-hander.
Decent crowd here for game one of the doubleheader. Expect some more for the nightcap. Again, with rain in the forecast, it's not quite going to be the crowd that we initially anticipated here on Independence Eve, with the fireworks having been postponed to July 28th.
Initially, we were hearing talks of 5,000 plus fans coming for the game, but still a solid showing here for this first game is that towards short. Nice play by Cobb to his feet. The throw to first is in time. Oh, what a play from Tremaine Cobb. What a stretch from Cedric Rose, and one up, one down to start the bottom of the fifth.
That's a beautiful play from Cobb, the Troy shortstop. Rangy to his left, sliding to stop the ball, turning and making a good throw to first base.
Tremaine Cobb helps out as pitcher gets the first out and brings up Evan Goforth, who has been even hotter than Livermore today. He's got 3 RBIs on 2 singles. First pitch is a ball on the count 1-0.
Yeah, Evan really starting to put it together at the plate. He had a double off the wall in game one of the doubleheader the Swamp Bats played on Saturday in Vermont.
Bounce that pitch away, and it's 1-1.
And Goforth, the guy is known for his plus defense at third base. So if he can get things going with the bat, that would be a huge benefit for Sean McKenna's Swamp Bat.
Goforth from Indiana University, native of Borden, Indiana. Swings and misses on a breaking ball in the dirt, and it's 1-2. Hi, Alan, how are you? Most players in the New England League come from Division I colleges and universities. Many Power 5 players all over these rosters.
Yeah, Goforth out of Indiana. Teammate there of Swampbat Taylor.
Aside of that, also some of the best Division II, Division III, and junior college players in the nation, like the Swampbat starter today, Dylan King. 2-2, and that inside. This is full, 3 balls, 2 strikes. Inter Donato still searching for his first strikeout. Deals the payoff pitch, and that one bounced up the middle. Again, not going to be an easy play this time. It'll make it into center field. It's a one-out single for Evan Goforth, who's now 3-for-3 with 3 one-backers. It brings back up the top of the order in Jake Muma, who was the first batter that Inter Donato faced. Still no hits today for the shortstop. However, he has been walked and hit by a pitch. Also has an RBI on a ground out. Shows bunt, it's a fastball high, and Johnson will threaten the throw to first to get Goforth back to the bag. I know the count. It's just a 3-run ball game after the SteepleCats scored 3 in the top half of this inning. A swing and a miss moves us to 1-1. So the Swamp Bats use some insurance here in the fifth. Reminder, with this being a doubleheader, this is just a 7-inning ball game. Looking ground. 1-1, and Umar could not hold up. It's 1-2. You're watching the New England League here on ESPN Plus. This is just the third game ever of the NECBL on ESPN Plus. Thank you all so much for tuning in. As the 1-2 fastball high throw into second is in time. Go forth out, and that the second out of this bottom of the fifth. Fourth, that the first time this season he's been caught stealing. He's now 1-2. As that keeps Muma at the plate, but now gives him two outs. The 2-2 pitch, that misses low. And outside, Johnson thought it was going to be a called strike three. Count now full at 3-2. Payoff pitch. Swing and a miss, strike three. And the fastball up at 93 miles an hour. The second strikeout for Reed Intertonado. And that will send us into the sixth inning. Score 7-4. You're watching the NECBL on ESPN Plus. Adam Gackett and Jonah White with you here. You're watching the NECBL on ESPN Plus, and as the way things go in the New England League for the latter innings, I'll send the play-by-play back to the home broadcaster. Jonah, take it away.
Thank you very much, Adam. Shake Reinisch skies one to center. Jordan Smith waits and makes the catch, one out. Dylan King still on the mound. I feel like I'd have to go back and confirm this, but I think, Adam, this is the first time we've seen a swamp bat starter work into the sixth inning this season. Summer ball. And a lot of guys on innings limits, watching their pitch counts. That's a primary concern of all the coaches here is Tremaine Cobb steps in. He takes a strike, nothing in one, but Dylan King has got an efficient pitch count, 68 pitches through five innings, back out for the sixth.
It's hard to understate how big this is in a doubleheader, too.
Breaking ball, sky toward left. DeLamelier going back at the wall. He makes a catch! Blake DeLamelier! Not sure if that one was quite highway robbery, but a nice catch at the wall from Blake DeLamelier, two outs.
Unbelievable. I think that might be the second robbed home run, if not home run, at least robbed extra base hit of the day, as we take another look at that one up here on our monitor, and that probably might have gone out, I think, for Cobb, and that could have been another home run for him. Wow, that was as close as it gets.
That would have been close. Might have bounced off the top of the wall. I'm not sure. A couple looks at it on the replay. Either way, a nice catch by DeLamelier for out number two. Maybe his second home run robbery of the season.
Ryan Abel calls over DM Jefferson for a bit of a conversation. Cats bats have looked better here. Maybe Abel is seeing something from Dylan King.
Jefferson takes outside 1-0. Impressive for King after he walked the bases loaded and gave up three runs of the fifth, but got out of it with the lead still well intact. Coming out for the sixth, looking for a 1-2-3 inning. Zephyr is the official on-field cap of the NECBL, also known as the Z-Hats. Zephyr is the authentic college hat with over 800 colleges and channels the same energy and creativity into building custom hats of all types for pro sports teams, clothing brands, and companies everywhere. Make sure you pick up your Swamp Bats on-field cap today. There's a strike at the knees, and it's 3-1. One, low ball four. DM Jefferson draws his second walk, the fourth allowed by Dylan King. It'll bring up Cedric Rose.
By talked about this with a few Swamp Bats batters, but DM Jefferson, a guy who, even if he's struggling to get base hits, he's going to walk. That's the 16th time that he has walked this season.
OBP above 400 coming into this game. Very impressive. I'll tell you about another piece of NECBL equipment as Cedric Rose gets ready to hit with two outs and one on. It's Bruce Bolt, the choice of Major League All-Stars, the official batting gloves of the New England League. Bruce Bolt batting gloves are handmade by skilled craftsmen using 100% real Capretta leather. The stitching, materials, and unique design make these the best-fitting, most durable batting gloves at baseball. For more information, visit brucebolt.us. That's brucebolt.us. 1-1 pitch. High. Two balls and a strike. Dylan King, another impressive start for the Swamp Bats. Three-run fifth for the Steeplecats. A little bit of a blemish, but really any time you got a starter with a chance to go six innings, that's impressive here in the New England League. A lot of bullpen games. 2-1 pitch. Fouled off to the right and out of play. It's 2-2.
Keep an eye on Dean Jefferson on the base pass here. The count 2-2 and 2 outs. He's only 5-for-7 stealing bases this year, but it feels like almost all of those came in the first couple weeks of the season. He's got the speed. He just maybe hasn't been as aggressive.
Swing and a miss. Strike three. Got him with a slider in the dirt. And Bazo will complete the strikeout at first base with a little bit of confusion going on there with Jefferson. Good outing for Dylan King. Six innings, he strikes out four. And in the sixth for North Adams, no runs, no hits. One man left. We go to the bottom of the sixth. It is a seven-inning game. It's 7-1 Swamp Bats. This is the NECBL on ESPN+.
I'm turning dreams into reality. In the lab with the formula and chemistry. The memories spark and motivate and make the industry shake. We put the balls in the place. I'm talking one chance at best, yes. Painting pictures for the culture, keep the brushes fresh. Took the trouble, broke the drum of passion, never rest. Freedom is a time, the pressure now be blessed. Yeah, it's one on one. Now the future be yours, let's go.
First thing, first of all, it was quality, the consistency, knowing that when I take them out, they're going to be the same every time. And the second was to be able to see kids all over the country wearing the gloves that I designed. That's one of the coolest parts of this.
Unite your athletes. Empower your coaches. Rally your community. Support every team with one solution with the Huddle Athletic Department package. You put all your coaching tools under one roof. From recording to analyzing to sharing, with your Huddle AD package, you cover every angle. Equal access means equal opportunity, and equal opportunity means full potential. Take your department to the next level.
Bottom of the sixth, new pitcher for the North Adams Steeplecats, and it's Gavitt Stelfluke.
Stelfluke, the right-hander out of Rutgers, redshirted this past year after making 20 appearances for the University of Maryland in the season that they were one of the best teams in the country. Struggled a little bit to start his summer, but has really turned things on as of late. The big thing with him, is you got to look at his fastball velocity. Some games he's set 92, 93, others like 87, 88. So that's where you can kind of tell with Stelfluke.
There's 92 inside to Devitt Taylor, one ball and no strikes. It's 7-4 Swamp Bats. I mistakenly raced the three-run fifth inning, signing off after the top of the sixth for the Steeplecats, but it is 7-4. It was 7-1. But a three-run fifth has got the Steeplecats back in the game. But in a seven-inning contest, they've now only got 3 outs to play with, and it'll be their bottom of the order coming up in the seventh. Taylor pops one up out of play left side, 1-2.
Big thing with Stealth Lug's improvement over the past couple of weeks, if you take a look at him, he is a big guy, about 6'6", 230 pounds, and he is ripped, to say the least. He said he was maybe lifting a little bit too much. He was starting to lose some mobility because he had so much muscle. Since then, he started to take a little bit of time off the weight room, focus more on stretching and mobility, and when that's happened, the fastball velocity has came back.
Cannon sees that foul ball bounce into the bleachers. Still a ball and two strikes on Taylor. SwampBats scored four in the bottom of the second, three in the bottom of the third. North Adams with one run in the top of the third and three runs of the fifth. That's outside at 93 from Stealth Luke, 2-2. Reed entered Donato went 2 2/3, gave up two hits, no runs, one walk, and two strikeouts.
Promising first outing in North Adams for Inter Donato and another bullpen arm that the Cats will be able to rely on as some start to fall off due to reaching their innings limits.
That is fouled back and it's 3-2. Mentioned innings limits, pitch counts, and you said it earlier, so big, every out you can get, especially in a doubleheader, it's safe for the bullpen. It's huge for the SwampBats that Dylan King has given him six in the start. Taylor fouls one away. This might be a fair ball, actually. Jefferson chasing, and it's in for a hit. Bounces into the corner. Taylor is going to hit second and hit for third. Oh, the player is down there. Jefferson, it's going to be an inside-the-park home run for Devin Taylor. Concern here for Jefferson, who went down trying to field it. It's the third homer of the season for Taylor in the most unlikely of fashions. It's 8-4 SwampBats. And we hope that DM Jefferson is okay down the left field line.
Oh yeah, that's not what you want to see. It looked like as he went to kind of turn around and try and find, he overran it towards the left field line, and as he turned around, he just fell to the ground and grabbed something in his leg. We never want to speculate here, but it doesn't look good as the trainer will make her way out towards left field.
Jefferson, a good player, left-hand batter from Notre Dame. We sung his praises just now with his on-base percentage and ability at the plate. And, you know, it's tough with an inside-the-park home run. It's one of the most exciting plays in baseball on the one hand, but oftentimes it's caused by a play like this, where you've got an injury to an outfielder, and that, you know, it's the primary concern here is the well-being of these players. We'll take a break as they evaluate DM Jefferson. It's 8-4 SwampBats at the bottom of the sixth after the inside-the-park home run from David Taylor. This is the NECBL on ESPN+. Back at Alumni Fields in Keene, Nathan Lincoln is the new left fielder for the SteepleCats, and we hope and wish for the best with DM Jefferson after he hurt himself going for that fly ball down the line from Taylor that turned into an inside-the-park home run. Here's Garrett Rice. There's a strike of the knees, nothing and one. I don't know, that's the second inside-the-parker that I've seen in the last few games. SwampBats gave one up on Thursday in Martha's Vineyard. That saw Jordan Smith hurt himself in center field.
SteepleCats actually had one in Martha's Vineyard. So this is the second one that I've seen too. That was a Little League home run. It was a kind of a bunt base hit, error from the pitcher on the throw to first, and then when the first baseman threw it in, it was an error from
him. So not exactly a home run.
A Little League home run is what you would call it.
Fair enough. That's a true four base hit there for Devin Taylor. His third homer of the season as Rice gaps one toward right center. It'll be cut off in front of the warning track by Reinisch. And Garrett's going to hold on first with a single. What an offensive output here by the SwampBats. They now have 12 base hits in this ball game.
For a team that was hitting 188 and averaging under 3 runs a game, this is polar opposite from the rest of the season for Keene. You just hope, if you're a SwampBats fan, that they haven't used up all of the offense and all of the runs here in the first game of a doubleheader.
There's Blake DeLamelier. By the way, there's nobody warming up at the bullpen for the SwampBats. Tornberg is standing around down there, so there's a chance we see Dylan King try and finish this one out. 8-4 Keene. looking to add to it here in the bottom of the sixth against Stelfluke. A little squibber back to the mound. Stelfluke will go for the lead runner at second base, and Dot get him. Jared Rice slides in there safely. A mistake for the pitcher on an unsuccessful fielder's choice.
The miscommunication there. Both middle infielders thought that Stelfluke was going to go to first. Aiden Stewart said, I thought that was your ball to Tremaine Cobb. Stewart made the catch just behind the bag, and because of it.
Kind of lollipopped it over there, albeit with nobody covering, but they didn't get there in time.
Would have been in time if they were covering.
I think Stelfluke might have done better to just throw that to the bag and trust his fielders to get there. It's Jordan Smith, who's hit a home run and been robbed of a home run in his last two trips, comes to the plate.
I wonder how you scored as a fielder's
choice. Should be a fielder's choice.
Not an error.
No outs.
Even though you didn't get an out, yeah. It might be an error.
Smith
on the pitch
takes outside. It's 1-1. Now, Trevor doesn't know what he's talking about over there.
We'll see what the official scoring.
I kid, but it's not an error. That should be a fielder's choice. 1-1. Foul back, and it's 1-2. Matt Brown earring on deck. Swampbats looking to add to this four-run lead. Try and give their pitching, whether it's Dylan King or somebody else, some extra cushion for the top of the seventh and last. Smith goes down swinging there. One out now from Matt Brown earring.
Like it took a second for Gunnar Johnson to get back up. I don't know if he got hit by the bat or just going down. Heard something for a second. Looks like he's okay, but Jefferson just went down. Hope everyone's fine here in the SteepleCats, especially in the doubleheader.
Matt Brown Earing's had a good game, a walk and a single, 1-2. Takes it side. Say about the Steamship Authority. Whether you're an island resident or planning a summer getaway, the fastest way to get to the Cape and Islands is by taking the New England League's preferred partner, the Steamship Authority. Visit steepshipauthority.com for more information. 2-0 to Matt Brown Earing.
And you and I both took that Steamship Authority ferry last week.
We sure did. We took a fishing
ride.
Boat on the way back.
Yeah, that's maybe not as beautiful of a ride.
There's no snack bar on the fishing boat.
No. And some rough waters sometimes.
Too well.
At times we were airborne.
Did
on
he
way
go? Didn't look like it. Oh, no, the home plate umpire, beg your pardon, Don Geller, said that he did go. That's why they didn't appeal. It's 2-1.
Cool if you could appeal for it to turn from a strike to a ball. Of course, you can't do that.
It would
you can
be
only
interesting. Three balls, one strike.
It'd be
interesting if you had a limited number of appeals per game.
They've tried that out in the minor leagues where you can appeal actual
really?
Ball and strike
I didn't know
calls.
That.
It's like, have you seen in tennis?
Oh, that's like, not. But that's not for check swings. Ball
no,
four
that
I got throughout Erie. That's for right for the future is here, so to speak. Probably going to bring that to the major leagues in the next couple of years. Some sort of semi-robot automated strike zone. As Brown Earing draws the walk, the Swampbats have the bases loaded now for Greg Bazo, who's 2-for-3 with 2 runs scored. Pitch to Bazo. In for a strike, and it's nothing and one. Greg Bazo, the catcher from Northeastern, with Rice at third, DeLamalier at second, and Matt Brown Earing the runner at first. Up and in. Mazo ducks out of the way. I think Dylan King just made his way down to the bullpen to stay loose. That's inside 2-1. It's hard to see all the way down there, but it's number 11. That's what it looks like. I think that's the case, just with a long inning, trying to go back for the seventh. So he's clearly going to come out and at least start the top of the seventh inning, go for the first complete game of the season for the Swampbats. 2-1 pitch. Rounded off his foot, foul, 2-2.
Now I mean, that makes it so your second game you can really just treat as a standalone, because all you lose is one starting pitcher. That could have been the day before. Now you can work your
There's only been one complete game this season of the NECBL. Danbury Westerners had one, so King will be looking for only the second complete game across the league all season. We're halfway through it.
I mean, how often do you see a complete game, too, where four runs were allowed? That's another thing. But, I mean, he's just been so dominant. It was really that one inning, the top of the fifth, in which King gave up those runs. Outside of it, it's been really quick work. I mean, outside of that inning, he hasn't allowed more than four runners to come to the plate in a frame.
Yeah, he walked a few in that three-run fifth, but rebounded very nicely to now get through six innings, looking for his second win of the year.
Guys like him are used to going well over 100 pitches. It's just most of the time in summer ball, you see the leash being a lot shorter, and pitchers not really going above 80 ever. So it's not that his arm can't take it. It's just...
Yeah, earlier this season, we saw Dylan throw five scoreless innings and get pulled from the game afterwards. 2-2. God, out and missed. He chased one there. Two outs.
Took a little bit off at 87. Not sure if that's a fastball or maybe some cutter action there. Pitch similar to a cutter from Stealth Loop, but whatever it was, it absolutely fooled Bosley.
Livermore was robbed of a hit by the shortstop Cobb his last time up. Two outs of the bases loaded. The Swamp Bats lead by four. Ball one at 90 miles an hour down low. Eight runs on 12 hits for the Swamp Bats. Four runs on three hits for the SteepleCats. That is up and away. Two balls and no strikes. The nine hitter, Goforth, who's 3-for-3, waits on deck. Stelfluke trying to keep this one interesting going into the seventh inning. He's in trouble now, 3-0 on Livermore.
That's 79 to up for the Cats, all of which have scored runs so far today. So good part of the order up for North Adams.
A 3-0 to Tony. Strike down the middle, 3-1.
Livermore, a small guy in the box, kind of ducked out of the way to try and get the ball call, but that right down Broad Street.
I think it's Broadway, Adam,
yeah,
not Broad Street.
There
is a Broad Street in Lower Manhattan.
Yes, there's also one in North Adams.
Three balls and two strikes.
There's Broad Streets all over the place.
There are.
You can be down either. So, you know, be down anywhere. You can be down Main Street.
Runners go on 3-2, and it's fouled at the plate off the catcher, Johnson. And we'll see if Gunner is okay. Looks like he'll be able to shake it off, but the count remains full on Livermore.
He's just got him beat up in this inning. Hit by a couple balls. Like maybe got hit in the throwing hand there, shaking it off.
Tom Gala will clean off the plate. Make it look nice ahead of the 3-2 pitch. On a nice, albeit warm and a little bit humid, afternoon in Keene.
Humid to say the least.
Yeah, especially here in this press box. Outside, ball four. Second RBI of the season for Tony Livermore. He's aboard for the third time today. Rice scores from third. DeLamelier goes to third. Brown Earing goes to second on the RBI walk by Tony Livermore. It's 9-4 Swamp Bats. And the batter is Evan Goforth.
Keene with just some insurance in the bottom of the sixth, trying to put this game out of reach.
It's the second time this season the Swamp Bats have scored nine runs, and both of them have come against the SteepleCats.
First time, though, in 10 innings, this in just six.
Goforth taps the plate. The 0-1 pitch. Cut out a miss, nothing at two. Best game of the season for Evan. RBI infield hit in the second inning, came around to score. Two-run single in the third inning, and another single in the fifth inning. Stelflug's 0-2. Grounded to the left side. Picked by Hannon. His throw is in time. And that retires the shot. Some insurance runs for the Swamp Bats. Two of them. Two hits, including an inside the park homer. No errors, three left. It is 9-4 Swamp Bats. This is the NECBL on ESPN Plus. Sun showers are back. So we begin the top of the seventh inning. Dylan King looking for a complete game. He'll face Chad Bourne, Aiden Stewart, and Gunnar Johnson, starting with Bourne for Coastal Carolina. And he grounds one to the left side, backhanded by Mumaw. Long throw to first, in time. One pitch, one out. Attendance for today's game, 950 for game one of this doubleheader. Should be some more here for game two.
It's pretty solid for
a rescheduled game.
Absolutely interdivisional and a
with rain in the forecast.
4 p.m. start, rain throughout. Fans have stayed even though it's been raining. They seem to not care. There's a number of fans down the first baseline, still just out in the
That's a sun shower.
It is under some trees too, so I can't tell if they're getting wet or not. Either way, getting dried off by the sun, which is definitely helping out the field.
It's barely raining as Stewart singles through the right side. So now, four runs, four hits, no errors, and it's just two men left on base of the game for the Steeplecats. Nine runs, 12 hits, no errors, and nine men left on base for the Swamp Bats. So their best offensive game of the summer so far. Both teams coming into this game off the back of getting swept at a doubleheader on Saturday. Swamp Bats, though, have bounced back nicely here in game one. Here's Johnson, who's had a great day at the plate. Takes on the outside corner, a slider, nothing at one. A homer and a two-run double. Shivited three of the four Steeplecat runs.
Steeplecats have been a team of streaks so far this season. You almost have to think, okay, now they're going to lose that third in a row to officially make it a streak, not just back-to-back, and then they can get back to winning ways.
Now they get two here, the count. Johnson, yeah, the Steeplecats won an opening night, lost 12 in a row, then they won four in a row before getting swept by Danbury, the doubleheader on Saturday. Swamp Bats started 4-2. Here's the 0-2 swung on and missed strike three. Got him with a slider. Fifth strikeout for Dylan King, who is now one out away from the NECBL's second complete game of 2023.
I think it counts, right? Even though it's seven innings.
It's a complete game.
Yeah.
I think it's different with if you get a seven inning no hitter, something like that. I think you put an asterisk there, but complete game is a complete game, whether it's seven innings or nine innings.
And even if it is nine innings, he went seven, which is one heck of an accomplishment.
Cannon takes high, 1-0. It's been a great privilege to be able to watch Dylan King pitch for the Swamp Bats this summer. And certainly hope that one day he's had a chance to be one of the guys on the prestigious billboard that's near the first base grandstand here at Alumni Field with all the Swamp Bats Major League alumni. Two balls, no strikes to count on Kyle Hannon as the Steeplecats begin their third time through the batting order. Swing and a miss, 2-1. Just want to give a big thanks to all the folks who made this ESPN Plus broadcast happen. Steve Pierce with us here for the Swamp Bats. PJ Moynihan has done a wonderful job getting us set up. 2-1, popped up. Left side, they should do it. Go for it. Calling. He makes a catch. It's a complete game win for Dylan King. Embraces Greg Bozzo. 9-4 final here. SwampBats snapped their three-game skid. They beat the SteepleCats 9-4 in game one. And the seventh for North Adams. No runs, a hit, and one man left. Final score in game one. 9 for the SwampBats and 4 for the SteepleCats. Adam?
And it was an offensive domination today for the SwampBats. They got 2 on in the first innings, stranded up, but did not make mistake of the runners getting on in the second inning as 4 scored in the second frame. The bottom of the order getting things going with 6, 7, 8, 9 all reaching, all scoring. The SwampBats then added on 3 more in the third. Jordan Smith with a home run, and then the scoring came to an end with 2 more in the sixth, but that enough for 9 runs on the day for the SwampBats. Over for the SteepleCats, Gunnar Johnson had his best day of the season with a solo home run in the third, and then also a 2 RBI double in the fifth inning. Kyle Hannon had the other RBI for the Cats also in the fifth. Just 4 runs today, but a dominating pitching performance from Dylan King, and one of the better performances that we have seen all year long on the hill from any pitcher in this entire league. As you said, just the second complete game of any pitcher in the New England League so far this summer.
Yeah, clean game all around for the SwampBats. They do it in all 3 phases. Pitching, obviously, with King. They get a season-high 12 hits, 9 runs to tie a season-high. They play clean defense as well, not committing any errors today. Let's get you the final totals from this one for the SteepleCats. 4 runs on 4 hits, no errors, and 3 men left on base. For the SwampBats, 9 runs on 12 hits, no errors, and 9 men left on base. Dylan King is the winning pitcher. He improves to 2-1. Don Marcosio gets the loss. He drops to 0-1. 950 people were here to see it. Time of the game, 2 hours. This broadcast is copyright of the NECBL. SwampBats win it 9-4 for Adam Gottkin. I'm Jonah White. Thanks for tuning in. This has been the NECBL on ESPN+.